Japan is one of the most earthquake-prone countries in the world. In the past, people believed earthquakes were caused by the thrashing of a giant catfish. They were terrified of this manifestation of nature's power. But over the centuries, people in Japan accumulated know-how for coping with earthquakes. This wooden structure has stood for several hundred years. Its ingenious engineering enables it to withstand even massive earthquakes. That technique is now being applied in today's super high-rise structures. Meanwhile, engineers have even developed technology to lift entire houses off the ground when a quake strikes. Earthquakes can be accompanied by tsunami. One hero of Japanese history spent a great deal of his own money to protect people from the threat of tsunami. Today, volunteers from Japan go abroad to provide support when an earthquake strikes in another country. On this edition of Begin Japanology, our theme is earthquakes. We look at some ingenious disaster reduction measures and consider how they help Japan to be ready for the moment when disaster strikes.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for today is earthquakes. I'm in the city of Yaizu in Shizuoka Prefecture, which is part of the Tokai region, where three tectonic plates converge and where a major earthquake of the kind that's been occurring periodically over 100 to 150 year cycles is already overdue. This is the Yaizu City Fire and Disaster Safety Center. They have a disaster education facility indoors where you can actually experience what happens during a disaster. I'm going to go in and take a look. Japan is prone to earthquakes and other natural disasters, and they have public facilities like this all over the country where they educate people of all ages about disaster reduction. They even have an earthquake simulator here, which I'm told I have to try out later in the show. First of all, though, let's take a look at what people in Japan do to try and reduce the threat posed by earthquakes.
Japan has always been hit frequently by major earthquakes. In fact, a full 20% of the world's earthquakes exceeding magnitude 6 occur in Japan. In the past 10 years, there have been more than 200 quakes of magnitude 6 or greater within the territory of Japan. The most destructive quake in modern Japanese history was the Great Kanto Earthquake of 1923. There was a tragic loss of life, more than 100,000 people dead or missing. The date of the Great Kanto Earthquake, September the 1st, is now designated as Disaster Prevention Day. Drills are conducted all over Japan. Even in primary schools, earthquake evacuation procedures are taught regularly. In Tokyo, which bore the brunt of the Great Kanto Earthquake, many primary schools hold drills monthly. This is a drill. This is an evacuation drill. Earthquake. In the event of an earthquake, pupils hide under their desks for protection from falling furniture or debris. They must follow their teacher's instructions instantly. The pupils put on protective hoods, which each of them is required to keep at school. The hood helps to protect the head from flames or falling debris. Thanks to frequent drills, this primary school is able to assemble 600 pupils in the schoolyard within 4 minutes of starting the evacuation. In fact, hoods just like those worn by the children are also kept at the seat of Japanese government. This is the chamber of the House of Representatives. The ceiling features stained glass. Due to fears that the glass would shatter in an earthquake, all the members of the House have ready access to a protective hood. Made of flame-resistant, aluminized fabric, these hoods also help to keep Japan's elected representatives safe. In Japan, earthquake readiness is part of everyday life. Nobue Kunizaki focuses on the housewife's viewpoint and thinks up ways to make homes safer in the event of an earthquake. Her own home is full of ingenious ideas. Anti-slip surfaces on shelves help to prevent dishware from falling. A latch on the refrigerator ensures that its contents won't come flying out. Other measures used in Japan include braces to prevent furniture from toppling and straps to secure a TV to the wall. Many people also keep knapsacks filled with emergency supplies so that when something happens they can make a quick escape with all the must-have items. In Japan, from the National Diet Building to private homes, earthquake readiness is deeply ingrained in everyday life.
I spent the first 23 years of my life living in England where I never once felt an earthquake. And then the first weekend after coming to Tokyo, I think it was, I was staying at a friend's house and got woken up in the middle of the night with what seemed like the whole house shaking. The Japanese people in the house all took it in their stride, but I can remember being completely unnerved by it. Thankfully, in all the years I've lived here since, I've never been close enough to a really big earthquake to have been frightened by it, though. Now, this setup here simulates the shaking of a number of actual earthquakes that happened in the past, including the 1995 quake that devastated Kobe. This is the mission I've been given. Okay, well, I suppose I'm about as ready as I'm ever going to be, so start her up, please. Well, that wasn't as bad as I was expecting, but then I was expecting something to happen. I think if I'd been at home or out in the street or hopefully not in a subway train or something, and suddenly a shock of that sort happened, I would have been in total panic. If you want to be prepared for an earthquake, it helps to have buildings that are not going to collapse immediately. Next, we're going to take a look at some techniques developed in Japan over the centuries to help defend against earthquakes.
One of the scariest things about earthquakes is the collapse of buildings. In 1662, Kyoto was struck by the Kambon earthquake. The shrine gate of Yasaka Jinja toppled, and hundreds of people perished when buildings collapsed on them. But some wooden structures survived the quake, which was a powerful one, exceeding magnitude 7. One survivor was Nishi Honganji, a Buddhist temple in Kyoto now registered as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. The ceiling of the central hall is 29 meters high and the room is 62 meters across. This hall, the Goeido, can accommodate 3,000 people, and it has withstood the shock of many quakes over a period of 360 years. What keeps the Goei doll from toppling? In 1998, a 10-year restoration project was initiated, and in the process, the secret of the building's strength against quakes was revealed. Associate Professor Hidekazu Nishizawa of Kansai University conducted the study. He attached seismometers to the columns and beams, and then sent vibrations into the structure to assess how they propagated. There were some experts who predicted that an earthquake of considerable intensity would threaten the Goei doll, but Nishizawa disagreed, and the results of his experiment showed that the deformation of the structure was actually extremely small, confirming his theory. The roof of the Goei doll weighs 3,000 tons. It's supported by columns just 40 centimeters thick, slender for a building this size. There are 68 of these columns spaced 2 meters apart around the perimeter of the building. And there are 46 more columns around the central worship hall. These numerous columns support the roof, acting almost like walls. This arrangement resists structural deformation of the building. In addition, the extensive wooden bracketing that connects the columns with the roof serves an important function in quake resistance. The creaking of the joints between the timbers effectively absorbs the shaking of the earthquake. Actually, the anti-seismic construction that everyone is clamoring about now is something that Japan has been doing for more than 1,000 years. And in modern history, these techniques reached a very high level. Careful reviews of Japan's traditional building methods have resulted in better architectural design. Japan also boasts a style of building that has never yet been toppled by an earthquake, the five-story pagoda. There are around 60 of them still standing nationwide, and there's no record of any Japanese five-story pagoda ever falling in an earthquake. What these pagodas have in common is a single large column running down the center. It's called the core column. It's not joined to the columns and beams around it, and does not support the weight of the pagoda. But it's believed that the core column is the key to a pagoda's outstanding quake resistance. And this structural ingenuity has been applied to a modern structure. Strong against quakes.
We've now moved just up the road from Yaizu to the adjacent city of Shizuoka, and this is their disaster prevention center. In addition to the damage caused by earthquakes themselves, the tsunami that are sometimes triggered by them can also inflict terrible harm. When I was a kid, we used to use the word tidal wave, but the Japanese word tsunami seems to be used universally these days. This pillar here behind me shows the height of a tsunami that followed a major earthquake that hit this area in 1854. You can see it varies from about 2 meters all the way up to more than 7 meters. Okay, next let's take a look at a historical figure who saved many people from a tsunami.
The town of Hirogawa in Wakayama Prefecture. In the early 19th century, it was a quiet fishing village with a population of 1,300 people. Hamaguchi Goryo was born and raised in Hirogawa. He was a prosperous merchant who spent half of the year away from Hirogawa making and selling soy sauce in Edo and Choshi. One evening in 1854, an earthquake occurred off the coast of Wakayama, the Ansei Nankai earthquake. With an estimated magnitude of over 8, the earthquake itself was extremely destructive. Goryo was indoors, but immediately after the quake he looked outside and saw a strange cloud over the sea. There was a weird light and a mighty roar. These phenomena reminded him of tales that had been passed down through the generations. Goryo realized that tsunami was probably on the way. He headed out to warn the other villagers to evacuate to high ground around the local shrine. Then the first tsunami wave swept in. Goryo narrowly escaped with his life. But only a fraction of the village's population had reached the high ground. Goryo grabbed a torch and set fire to sheaves of straw piled in the fields. This lit the way to the shrine in the darkness for those who had been late to escape. That day, 5 tsunami waves swept ashore. But Goryo's quick thinking to set fire to the sheaves to signal the evacuation saved the lives of most of the villagers. Finally, after the tsunami had receded, the villagers assessed the devastation to their homes and fields. Goryo then decided to invest his own money in a seawall to offer protection against future tsunami. To build it, he enlisted the help of his fellow villagers. Goryo designed a massive seawall 900 meters long, 7.5 meters thick at the base, and 4.5 meters high. This was before the age of heavy construction machinery. Even with 1,300 villagers working on it, Goryo had no idea how long it would take to complete. Young and old, all gathered to do their bit. For families that had lost homes and fields, this project provided crucial cash income. Overcoming many difficulties, the villagers completed the seawall 4 years after the earthquake. It was the world's first earthen seawall built to protect against tsunami. About 100 years later, in 1946, another major quake struck the area, the Showa Nankai earthquake. A tsunami 4 meters high swept ashore. But thanks to the seawall, most of the village sustained no damage. Today, what was once a little fishing village is home to 8,000 people. Every year, Hirogawa holds a tsunami festival to ensure that the lessons of the past are not forgotten. The local children offer prayers for the town's safety and symbolically pile soil onto the seawall. Here is a quote from local hero Goryo. "Don't put things off until disaster strikes. Do your utmost to be fully prepared for emergencies in everyday life." That is sound advice if you wish to be prepared not only for a tsunami, but for any kind of disaster.
A story based on this dramatic rescue is familiar to most older Japanese because it used to be in Japanese textbooks. I'm sure many people around the world became aware of the word tsunami as a result of the massive earthquake that rocked Southeast Asia at the end of 2004. To contribute to disaster readiness education, the Japanese government arranged for the same story to be translated into 9 different Asian languages. And I have a few of the pamphlets that were made as a result of that here. This first one is in Indonesian. This one's from the Philippines. This is from Singapore, that's in English. And this one's in Tamil. The details of the stories seem to have been adapted to fit into the societies of each country. In the wake of a major earthquake, of course, government assistance is vital. But government can't do everything, and that's where volunteer activities become very important.
At 5:46 a.m. on January the 17th, 1995, a massive earthquake struck Kobe, one of Japan's biggest cities. Registering a magnitude of 7.3, it claimed 6,300 lives. It was the greatest natural disaster to strike Japan in recent decades. Seeing the tragedy unfolding before their eyes, hundreds of thousands of volunteers from all over Japan came to Kobe to offer assistance. Since then, Japan has been hit by several other big earthquakes, and each time volunteers have come forward to help. Now, earthquake relief volunteer initiatives are transcending national borders. In May 2008, a massive earthquake struck Sichuan, China, leaving 87,000 people dead or missing. The news of the tragedy quickly traveled around the world, and volunteers arrived from many countries.
Okay, I'll get some people for you.
2 years later, new buildings are springing up like mushrooms in Chengdu, Sichuan's major metropolis. Even as reconstruction proceeds, some volunteers remain involved. Masamichi Yoshitsubaki is one of them. Yoshitsubaki is a member of a Kobe-based NGO. His work is supported by donations sent mainly by people who lived through the 1995 earthquake in Kobe. Yoshitsubaki was on the ground in Sichuan 3 days after the quake. Now he drives 3 hours each way every day to a small village in the mountains where little reconstruction has occurred. Yoshitsubaki began visiting this village soon after the earthquake, and has been helping the people there with everything from clearing rubble to planting fields and pulling weeds. He has won the complete trust of the villagers. Yoshitsubaki values one thing above all else in carrying out volunteer work: listening to what disaster victims have to say. It's important that every individual victim of disaster have a voice. The support we offer to them is rooted above all in what individuals have to say. He started thinking this way during his first experience as a volunteer in Kobe. When Yoshitsubaki first arrived in Kobe from Fukuoka, he didn't know exactly what to do either, and he felt powerless. But then Yoshitsubaki started helping out at a foot bath. Disaster victims had no access to full-scale bathing facilities, and the foot bath offered some degree of relief for their fatigue. Slowly, the disaster victims began to open up to Yoshitsubaki as he worked at the foot bath. The people at the footbath were shedding tears of joy. That's when I realized that even without any special skills, I could just be there for people, hearing their stories, crying and laughing along with them. You can always make a positive difference for people by listening to them. Yoshi Tsubaki says that even now, 2 years after the quake in China, people there have psychological wounds, which is precisely why it's so important to listen to them. He has been working in the village for 2 years. In Kobe, he revived a local autumn festival that had been abandoned since the quake. Now he's setting out to do the same in China. In Kobe, the festival helped to bring people back together again and revive their spirits. That experience made Yoshi Tsubaki keenly aware of the importance of local ties. Despite rainy weather, large crowds gather on the day of the festival. Smiles return even to the faces of those who lost their homes and even family members. I'm so grateful. Japanese volunteers have brought us a bright future. I have hope that I've never known before. Not just financial and material aid, but also emotional support is needed to help disaster survivors to get back on their feet. Japan's own profound experience with earthquakes has cultivated a volunteer spirit that is now bringing hope to disaster victims around the world.
This is a picture of the aftermath of that earthquake in Sichuan. It's a pretty sobering sight, isn't it? Of course, you can't prevent earthquakes, and in Japan alone, every year there are about 2,000, and those are only the ones that you can feel physically. If you're ever unlucky enough to experience an earthquake during a trip to Japan, try to stay calm. I know that's easier said than done. But also remember that Japanese people have more experience coping with disasters than just about any other nationality in the world. I'll see you again next time.